Hi, so this is the last lecture on statistical property of hyperbolic dynamical system with an emphasis on transfer operators. So what are we going to say today? Well, let me just share the screen and so I can continue with what I was talking about last time. Okay, so this was the norm we were discussing, and once you know, so the game here is that a priori is not really obvious what is the right norm to use in order to study the transfer operator. So I remind to you that the transfer operator, it is just, well, for a general hyperbolic dynamical system, it will look like this. It will be, even if it, okay, let's do the case in which it is an endomorphism, but we are looking at the homeomorphic, diffeomorphic. So, but okay, if it is an endomorphism, then it will be like this. Sorry. So this will be the transfer operator. Of course, if the map F is a diffeomorphism, then you have only one preimage, and then you have just the so it, for diffeo, have that L H X will be simply H compose F minus 1 of X divided the determinant of D F minus 1 of X F. And if Lebesgue is preserved, then it means that the determinant is just one, then this is going just to be, and this would be the case, for example, for billiard, this one. So this kind of, it's always the same object, but according to the type of system you're looking at, it just takes a slightly different form. But it is always the object that gives you the push forward, the density of the push forward of the measure. Okay. So the issue that we, as I said already, is that we want to study the spectrum of this operator. And the idea is that you want to study it in an appropriated space, maybe a Banach space, maybe a Hilbert space. I mean, here I'm doing Banach spaces. There are versions that were started by Vivian Baradin, which you can do it in Hilbert spaces, which is kind of more convenient in certain cases. So the point is that somewhat the norm or the scalar product of this Hilbert space, in this case is Banach space, the norm should reflect somewhat the property of the map. This, as I explained last time, these norms reflect the property insofar the function are regular in one direction and are dual of regular in the other direction. This reflects exactly the dynamics, the properties of the geometry of the dynamics. So in some sense, you embed in the norm the geometrical property of the system. And so this is kind of not obvious how to find the right way of doing this, so to define the right norm. But once you have the right norm, everything boils down to a rather boring computation that I'm not going to do for you. You can look at it in the notes. Or if you want all the details in the articles, because you know it's just computing stuff. I mean, you have to know how to compute, but essentially it's just computing stuff. So let me just tell you what the result of this computation is. So the result of this computation is that this one, so this 0q, let me remind you, it means that you are not taking any derivative on h. So essentially, you are just considering h as some kind of distribution because it is integrated against phi. It's not really, you know, if this is a stable manifold. So if the system were only expanding, and so there was the stable manifold would just be points, or actually maybe collection of points, depend how you want to define, then this thing here would simply be essentially the soup, right? Because you just take the values, the soup on H. So that would just be the C0 norm essentially. In a purely expanding case. And here instead, so it gives you no control on the regularity of the map, so of the function. So we know that this is not enough. We need also some control on that. And so we need to consider the case in which P is bigger than zero. And in this case, you get for some mu this. I mean, this constant C and B are just constant that depend only on the map. And here, what do you get? You get P minus one, Q plus one. So you need, you get that you have a decrease in the PQ norm, but you pay a price in the P minus one, Q plus one norm if P is bigger than one. Is bigger than zero. So start one, two, three. Here, for in this case, I just consider P integer one. One could change a little bit the situation, consider P real, but it doesn't change that much. So what is the meaning of this? This is clearly a weaker norm because you control less derivative. You see, you have P smaller here. P minus one, so you will control less derivatives, and you will integrate against functions since Q is replaced by Q plus one that are more regular. So clearly it's a weaker norm, because you integrate with respect to fewer functions and you integrate more derivatives. So it's clearly a weaker norm. And in fact, it is also something that one can check that the space B, PQ, actually the unit ball in this space, this is, oops. Is relatively compact in B, P minus one, Q plus one. Okay, I remind you that I didn't say okay, but I remind you what is B, P, Q. You just take the C infinity function and you close them with respect to the P, Q norm. So it's just the usual way, you start from the C infinity function and then you close the space with respect to the norm, you complete it. And that is the Banach space you are interested in. Okay, very well. We are all happy with this because this we recognize this stuff. These are the Lasota-York type inequality. This is the required compactness. we can apply Hennion theorem that we discussed already. And so we get some information about finally the spectrum of L, and you get the following information. Mm-hmm. So this B one. Okay. And then there will be and then there will be some smaller circle here. It's not really that good. Okay, and well, circle are not so concentric, but that's okay. You can imagine the right picture. So this one, see, if I look at the spectrum of L, I look at the spectrum of L in BPQ, then actually this nu, there is a further information that nu is less or equal lambda. You remember that lambda was the minimal expansion in the stable or the minimal contraction, the minimal expansion in the unstable or the minimal contraction in the stable. So this would be lambda to the minus the minimum between P and Q. Okay, so it's something that if you increase P and you decrease Q, then this guy will, and also you need that if F is CR, then P plus Q better be smaller than R. Smaller. Well, it depends from certain cases, but let's say strictly smaller. And so it means that when P and Q increase, then the spectral radius, the essential spectral radius, that is this one, so this is the essential spectral radius. This will decrease with the regularity of the node. Okay, that's helpful for certain things. But if you want just to see, you know, the decay of correlations, then here there will be an eigenvalue. So one again belongs to the spectrum of L. And if F is ergodic, then it is a simple eigenvalue. So it means that the eigenvector is the SRB measure. SRB measure is the Sinai-Bauer. Ruel, so the Sinai, Ruel, and Bauer measure. So this is the way in which you get in this scheme the SRB measure. It is just the eigenvector of the maximal eigenvalue. And okay, that's nice. If the system is ergodic with respect to the SRB measure, then the actually is ergodic with respect to the back. So the back in general, it may not be an invariant measure. It depends from, as I was saying, it depends from which situation you are in. I mean, if the bag is preserved, then the SRB measure is the bag, of course. But if the bag is not preserved, then you have this transfer operator here, and then you will get an SRB measure. Okay, fine. Which will be absolutely continuous with respect to the bag. But still, also if the bag is not ergodic, you can talk about ergodicity with respect to the bag. It simply means that if a set is invariant, then the bag measure is either zero or one. It's exactly the same. So this makes perfect sense. And so you get that the SRB measure is unique in this case, if the system is ergodic with respect to the bag. And if it is mixing, then if it is, or in alternative, also, I mean, if it is topologically transitive. Yeah, I mean, so if it is a godic with respect to the bag, is simple. Another possibility, if, which is maybe more sensible, if F is topologically transitive, then one is simple. If F is topologically mixing, then one is the only eigenvalue of modulus 1. So what does this mean? It means that on the unique circle there are no other eigenvalues. But since the essential spectrum is strictly smaller than one, then it means that there are only finitely many, at most finitely many eigenvalues outside this gray circle. Inside, of course, there can be anything. And in particular, since there are only finitely many eigenvalues here, it means that you have the maximal ones, and there is a spectral gap, some distance from the unit circle. Okay? So it means that you get automatically a dichotomy. Either the system is mixing, and then if it is mixing, it will decay the correlation. Sorry, if the system is not mixing, and then of course you don't have decay of correlation. Or if it is mixing, then the correlation decays exponentially fast. Then you get that if F and G are in C infinity, you get, sorry, H and G. You get that G compose Fn on the manifold time H minus the integral of G with respect to H SRB. This is the SRB measure time the integral of H. This is less or equal than what? Well, it is less or equal than you have H B PQ, and then you have G, which are just function. So this, in principle, should be the dual of BPQ, which is not so easy to define. But in this case, it is just let's call BPQ. Let's state the pre-dual, which we know what it is, and then you get e to the minus alpha n, and then there is some constant that does not depend only on the constant. And what is this norm here? Well, this is just the sup on alpha. Well, it is just the sup, sorry, on the manifolds in sigma of the norm of G seen as a function P plus Q time differentiable on the manifold V going in C. So you just restrict G to the manifold V, and then you look at many times it is differentiable, and that's what appears there as a norm. So of course, what does this mean? It means that okay, you have a decay of correlation for smooth function. But it's kind of clear that you have much more, right? Because you could start, then you can complete. So you can take any, so by just a stupid approximation, it means that for each, if A and this are just, H can be a distribution and G can be some kind of function. So you just need that H B PQ is less or equal than one, and G and this norm here that I called B P Q star is no, is finite, it's not less than one. It's finite, less or equal. And this is finite, So just two objects like that, so in particular G can be horrible in some direct, it must be just regular along the manifold W's, but it does not need to be in the transversal, to W in the unstable direction, can be rather horrible. And on the other end, H is just a distribution, so it's just some weird function. So, and still you get that you have exponential decay of correlation. So it is, to my knowledge, this provides you somewhat the largest class of objects for which you get decay of correlation, right? All right. So not just function, but even for certain distribution, you get decay of correlation. Very well. And so this is the situation. In this situation of maps. But now, so, and then of course, given this, you can try to do the same thing that we did for expanded map, trying to prove central limit theorem, the law of large number, Berry SN estimate, perturbation theory, linear response, all this machinery. Is available now since you have this language of transfer operator and the spectral theory of transfer operator. So you can you know, put in place all kind of machinery that is abstract machinery that is available. Okay, so what about flows instead? Okay, so you have a flow, phi t, from some m to itself, and this is an Ausdorff. And also, what does it mean? It means simply exactly like it's like the same thing for that we meant for a map. There are cones that get contracted, cones that get expanded, but now there is a neutral direction. So if you want to say in another way, you can say that at any point, you can split the space in three subspaces. So this, you take a point and you have the tangent space at that point. And in this tangent space, you will have some stable direction. This is ES. You will have some unstable direction. This is EU. And you will have also some flow direction. Zero. So if zero is the flow direction, of course, in the flow direction, you don't have expansion or contraction. And this is the problem for flows. Flows are intrinsically, they are not uniform hyperbolic. What is called uniform hyperbolic flow really is really a partial hyperbolic object. Because if you look at the flow at time one, then you have a map. And this map is only partially hyperbolic because it has a direction in which you don't get neither contraction nor expansion. It has a central direction. And obviously, that is a central direction, and it's kind of obvious because if you know, you are you are following a flow and some guy is 2 seconds in front of you, you can wait 2,000 years and then it will still be 2 seconds in front of you. So in that direction, you know, if you have some distance with the person in the flow direction, this will not really change very much in the future or the past. So that is a central direction. So now you have a problem that you have to deal somewhat in some way. So what do you do? Well, essentially, you use exactly the same nodes that we mentioned before. So you have still the stable curves or stable manifold, and they are still expanded and going backward in time. You can still define this object here, this integral along the curve. So you can define exactly the same norm. And then you can do the computation, but now you discover something slightly unpleasant. Okay, so you have still, now the transfer operator is just a semigroup. Oops. Let's just consider the situation in which it is area preserving or volume preserving. So it will just be the composition with the flow at time minus t. And now you can look, for example, at LTH PQ. And this will be smaller than a constant time H PQ. Oh, sorry. Yeah, well, that's okay. And then this is not very good because it does not give you any contraction. Okay, so but this, in fact, you can get for some alpha, some constant here, L, T, H, P, Q. Then you have to pay some price in the, oops, sorry, there is no L here. You have to pay some price in the weaker norm. But unfortunately, you have also the derivative in the flow direction. There is nothing you can do about the derivative in the flow direction. So it remains there. And what is x? X is just the derivative in the flow direction. So that is what x is. It's just, if you want, is the generator of this flow. And just take the derivative. So this is just the derivative with respect to t of L, t, h. So if you compute it for t equals zero, and more generally, you have that the derivative with respect to t of L th is equal to x lth. So in some sense, lt is essentially e to the xt, right? This is the solution of this differential equation. If you can make sense of it, then this is more or less what you expect. Okay, so you have that, you don't do much with that because this term here on the right is kind of as it has as many derivatives of this guy, and it has no contraction. This has a contraction, but this not. And so it seems that you are in bad trouble. This norm do not work as such. Okay, now situation departs. You can either look for better norms, and this was done indeed by Fau and Tsuji. They got better norms in which, in fact, you can get for a bona fide Lasota-Yorke inequality type thing for the flow. Or in alternative, you can just say, well, but after all, what I'm really interested in is the spectrum of the generator this time, not so much the spectrum of the semigroup. So if you are looking for that, then you want to look at the spectrum of the generator. Generator is X, is an unbounded operator. It essentially is the action of the vector field on function. So you can look at Z1 minus X minus 1. This is the resolvent. And clearly, if you understand what the resolvent mean, when the resolvent is well defined, then you have that Z is in the spectrum, is not in the spectrum of X. So if this operator is not well defined, Z1 minus X, then it means that you are in the spectrum of X. So studying this operator, this is spectral theory essentially, studying this operator tells you if you are or not in the spectrum of X. So this is slight shift of idea. Instead of looking at the spectrum of LT, you look at the spectrum of the generator, which is kind of something that people do, for example, in stochastic processes all the time. So again, we are kind of looking in the books of stochastic theory, seeing, ah, look at these people, what do they do? Ah, they study the spectrum of the generator. Ah, okay, let's try to do the same also in dynamical system. Let's see if we can study the spectrum of the generator. So there is a very nice formula for these guys. This formula is actually okay if why? Well, because this Lazota-York type inequality, even though it's not good enough in order to study the spectrum of LT, nevertheless is good enough to show that the LT does not grow. You see, the first one tells you that LT does not grow with T. Here, it simply does not grow with T. So it means that if you look at this integral, you apply it to a function H that is in BPQ, then this will not grow with T, but the real part is negative, is positive. So here the real part is negative, and so this integral is convergent. So if instead the real part is negative, then you are in trouble because the this one will grow. So you need some decay here in order to make this well-defined. And that's not obvious at all. So this formula works for that, but immediately tell you something. It tells you immediately that the spectrum the spectrum of the generator is contained on the left half plane, half complex plane, because in the positive complex plane, strictly positive complex plane, you have that you have an explicit formula for the resolvent. So the resolvent is a well-defined bounded operator, and so it means that Z belongs to the resolvent of the to the resolvent set. So the complement of the resolvent set is the spectrum. So you immediately know that the spectrum looks like this. So this is very nice. Since you see, you know that morally the sorry, what is it? Morally you expect L. So this, so actually, in this situation, there is a spectral theorem that tells you that the spectrum of L is equal to the exponential of the spectrum of S X. But in fact, it does. If you look at the hypothesis, they do not apply. Yeah? You need more stringent hypothesis than what we have in this case. So it's not clear, it's not does not follow from here. In fact, it is true, but you have to use this for Tsuji theory to see it, that the spectrum of this guy is the exponential of this guy. But nevertheless, morally it is more or less true. And so if you have that the spectrum is contained in the real part less or equal than zero, this implies that the spectrum of this guy is contained in the unit disk, which is what you expect, right? So this is kind of something contained in the unit disk is like saying that this guy is on the left half plane. So that is kind of nice. All right, and now we have some further idea. And the further idea is that, you see, what was our trouble? Our trouble was this one. This was our trouble. We had a problem controlling what happened in the flow direction. But now look at this formula here. This is integrated in the flow direction. But the integral is a compact operator. So it looks like this is much nicer to handle. And in fact, it is possible to prove the following. If you, Z is equal to A plus IB, then this to power N, Q is less or equal, then some constant, and then you have A. Sorry. Okay, so that what that what you get. So this is kind of the and of course you have so what does this mean? It means that, sorry. If you have here a point A plus B, A plus EB, then you look at the spectral radius of Z, and this tells you that the spectral radius of Z is given by a circle, which is so. You have to transform, I have to do a computation, I'm sorry. I have to look at what happens. So if I have Z, that, I don't want to call it Z, let me call it X. If I have X that belongs to the spectrum of X, then of, what does it mean? It means that X minus x, okay, this is not, or let's say complement, okay, so then it means that xi minus x minus one is well defined, okay, so let's say that now I have I have an eigenvalue. Okay, let's do the situation for eigenvalue, which is easier. Okay, let's do the situation for eigenvalue. Let's imagine that I have z minus, and then this has an eigenvalue c. Okay, so what does it mean? It means that h is equal to z minus x, c h. So I take this on the other side, and I get that x minus 1 h is equal to z h minus x h. So that means that x h is equal to z minus x minus 1 h. And so it means that z minus x minus 1 belongs to the spectrum of x. So there is a relation between the spectrum of the resolved point in the spectrum of the resolvent and point in the spectrum of X, and is given by this thing. And what does this, this is a map of the complex plane to itself that sends circles into circles. And if you have, so which circle, so if you have a point here, which is A plus IB, and you have that you have an eigenvalue. Let's say that you have an eigenvalue that is xi is equal to A minus one, like it seems to happen here, you see, a minus one. So it would be the maximal eigenvalue. And then if you put it there, then you get z, which is, sorry, you get a plus eb minus a, which is eb. Okay, so it means that the eigenvalue would end up here. And since this is a map, a conformal map that sends circle into circle, it means that, and it sends circle into circle, yes, but it sends also the interior in the exterior. So it means that if you know that sigma of Rz is contained in the set Z minus I don't have enough time. I don't have enough space to write. This is annoying. Let me write it here. Sigma of R Z. Okay. So this is contained in the Xi such that Xi is less or equal, let's say, than A minus one. Then you have that sigma x intersection this this one, so this is z, and this is a disk of radius a, so intersection xi minus z less or equal than a, this is empty. So it means that the spectrum of x must be outside, okay? This. Okay, so that going back here, it means that this inside here, there is no spectrum, but this we knew already. I mean, this we know that on this side, there is no spectrum. Here is just telling you that in all this region, there is no spectrum. So you learn even less than you knew before. But this tells you that the essential spectrum is given by that. So there is a larger radius. In which there is no essential spectrum. And now you are learning something new. You are learning that in this region here, there is no essential spectrum. Yes, there is no essential spectrum. And since B is arbitrary, you can move B this up and down, keeping A fixed. And this shows to you that you have a line and the essential spectrum of X is here. So you have, we learn, then sigma X essential is contained in real part of Z less or equal than, here there is some, I don't know, nu, less or equal than nu, nu star, whatever that is. Okay, so now you get the picture in which, in fact, this is an eigenvalue. Then there can be eigenvalue here, but they cannot accumulate. Okay, so this is kind of a very nice situation, because now you discover something, and also this guy, the guy depends on P, actually, right? So this depends on on P and Q. When P and Q increase, this guy moves on the left, okay, in some way. I'm running out of time, so I cannot really be too specific about that. Okay, so this is what happens. And then there is a last problem, that in principle, this eigenvalue could accumulate this eigenvalue So here you have the essential spectrum, okay, maybe. Here you have the eigenvalues. And in principle, they could accumulate, they are all discrete, so they cannot accumulate in a finite region, but since this strip is unbounded, going to infinity, they could accumulate there, and then you would not have any spectral gap. And in order to deal this, the idea to deal with this problem is due to Dolgo-Piatt. And I'm afraid we don't have this kind of little bit tricky to do this estimate, and we have no time to go into it. So you have to look at the note for that. But I mean, once you can establish that there is a spectral gap, and this is the situation, is this type of argument is actually, it exists only for contact flows like geodesic. Well, Dolgo-Piatt originally did it for C1 foliation. In general, the stable and unstable foliation are very unregular, but if you are lucky and they are C1, then you can apply the original Dolgo-Piatt argument. Otherwise, you can apply argument inspired by Dolgo-Piatt that apply to contact flow, and otherwise, so this is Dolgo-Piatt, this is myself, and more recently there is some result that this argument can be applied generically for 3D anosov. This is Tsuji and Zhang. Okay, so that is the situation here. So there is only one last thing that I would like to mention, the fact that what happens if you have discontinuity. If you have discontinuities, and in particular billiards, then you have to do something, because the problem is that you take one of these manifolds W, you push it backward, even in the discrete case, and then what you will get a bunch of manifolds, because it will be cut by the discontinuity. Okay? And some of them could be very tiny. And so you have to deal with the fact that you can have a bunch of very, very tiny manifolds. So there are many ideas going back to Sinai, essentially, to deal with this problem. But in this framework that we are dealing with, it turns out that a good possibility is to look at a norm that is slightly different. You have to just add some extra ingredient. And the extra ingredient is that you want to say, in some sense, that when you integrate on something that is small, like a small manifold like this, now you have W, and you integrate H against phi, but W for some reason is very small, is one of these guys here, small, small. Then you take the soup on phi, which are, and you take CQ of WC, okay, as usual. But now this one, instead of being smaller than one, it would be smaller than the size of W to some power 1/Q, okay? And then you take the soup on the W, on every W, over, so this would be sigma plus or sigma minus, because they can be arbitrarily small. It's exactly as before. They are pieces of stable manifold, closed curves that are close to stable manifold that can be, and this is called the H strong norm. So you just introduce this idea of just allowing H to be quite large. So what does it mean? It means that this is finite. Then you essentially have that this integral can, if you integrate against a function that is of size one, then this integral would be of size, the size of W to the power one over Q. Okay, so that means that in fact, if the integral is done on something very, very, very small, then the size of the integral will be small, but not as, I mean, so there is this power, right? So it will not decrease as the size of the manifold, like it would happen for a regular function, but it will decrease still, but in some controlled way, but much slower. So it means that the function can be very, very wide on small scale, but not too wide because you control this norm. And then, you know, you just add this extra thing to the norm and more or less you do everything in the same way in which it has been done for the smooth case, and everything works even for billiards. And this is a work by Demers, Baladi, and myself in 2008. So rather recent work in which it is possible to obtain this thing. But I'm afraid I'm essentially out of time. However, I mean, maybe as a last comment, I wanted to emphasize that, you see, in order to get this result for the decay of correlation of Wheeler, there are a lot of ingredients that needed to be put together. And that took quite a long time. In fact, if you think about the proof of decay of correlation for maps, for billiard maps. So what is the billiard map? The billiard map is that the billiard, it is, you have some obstacles, two dimensional, right? We are talking about two dimensional billiard. So you have some obstacle and then you have a trajectory that reflects, goes in straight line and reflects elastically on the obstacles. And the point is that you can talk about a map, and the map is done like this. You take a point of collision on the boundary, so you have a coordinate from the boundary, and then you take, for example, the angle with the normal after the collision. And this is x and this is theta, and then this is x1, and this guy after the collision is theta 1. So f, this would be x1, theta 1. And this is the Poincaré map. And so for billiard with finite horizon, I'm talking about billiard with convex scattered. And finite disjoint convex scatterer. So I don't want this situation, for example. This is probably possible to deal. It's possible to deal it for the Poincaré map. It's probably possible to deal it with the flow. But since you have this extra singularity, it requires more work. So I will not discuss them at all. And finite horizon. So finite horizon, it means that any segment, so imagine that this is inside the torus, for example, this T2. So this is not finite horizon because, you know, if you take this trajectory, it does not collide with any, it's infinitely long and does not collide with any system. So, but if you put another obstacle here, okay, And maybe, yeah, then maybe another obstacle here. You put enough obstacles, then any segment will of some length will collide. And so in this case, then was Lai-Sai Yang that proved exponential mixing, but the proof was 98. Okay, so that it means that it took 20 years from the proof of Poincaré map for Poincaré map and the proof for flows, which is exactly the same result. Flow is exponentially mixing. So the reason for that is that there are all these extra technical problems that need to be addressed and fixed, and that was a little bit lengthy somewhat. Okay, so I'm afraid I went over time. I'm sorry, and I think I stop here. I don't think I would have much more things to tell you, but time is what it is. And so if you want to know a little bit more, you can look at the notes, which, okay, I apologize. They have been written a little bit quickly because, I mean, they were very tight time constraint put on us. And so we did what we could. So there may be some misprint and something that are not explained as well as they could, but okay, we did our best given the time. And so there are all the extra information that you may want to look at, and the reference for the original paper in order for if you want to get more information and continue and maybe work in this field. Then there is all the things that you possibly may need. Okay, thanks a lot. And I think I'll stop here.